In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. It is always a great joy to come and visit this blessed diocese of Los Angeles. When I come here, every time I see the work of God, the work of the Holy Spirit in this diocese, and the growth and the expansion, and I personally learn a lot from the service in this diocese, and I thank my beloved Father, His Eminence Metropolitan Serapion, for inviting me and giving this opportunity to share with you the joy of this blessed day of a new addition to the service and the ministry of the diocese by the ordination of a new priest. I congratulate His Eminence and I congratulate all of you with this blessed ordination. And also it is joy to be with His Grace Bishop Abraham and His Grace Bishop Kyrillos. And I always pray that the Lord may bless the ministry of this diocese more and more. And it is indeed a lampstand shining all over North America. Today, actually, is the fourth Sunday of Ascents. Usually, if the Feast of Pentecost comes earlier, we will have two Sundays in Ascents, the third Sunday and fourth Sunday. But this year, only we have one Sunday in Ascents. And the readings from after Pentecost to the end of the Coptic year are about the Holy Spirit. As you know, the liturgical year is divided into four seasons. Every season is 3 months. The first 3 months about love of God the Father, Tod Baba Hatur. The second 3 months, which start with Kyan and the celebration of the incarnation of the Son of God, we speak about the reading about the love of His only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. And this will take 3 months, which are Kyan, Tuba, and Shir. Then the following 3 months will be the period of the Holy Great Fast beside the 50 days, 110 years, almost 3 months, which end with the Feast of Pentecost. And then the last 3 months of the Coptic year, Ba'ona, Abib, and Misra, are about the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. So the reading of today and the reading of the third Sunday of Ascents gives us an idea about the spirit of the Holy Spirit, the characteristic of the Holy Spirit. If the Pentecost came early enough to accommodate to something, so the third side of Ascents, the gospel is about the Good Samaritan. And here actually the Bible teaches us about the Holy Spirit, the spirit of compassion, the spirit of practical love. And this love is not limited to any race or only to our relatives, but even to our enemies. And the example here is the example of the Good Samaritan. Today, actually, the gospel is about the spirit of victory, the spirit of victory. Through the temptation of our Lord Jesus Christ on the mountain. And that's why the gospel started, then Jesus being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. So the church is telling us when we are filled with the Holy Spirit, when we are tempted in this world, we will have victory. We will have victory, because the Holy Spirit is a spirit of victory. And that's why the Lord, before his ascension, said to the disciples, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit come upon you. And we saw today how the Lord Jesus Christ, who was filled with the Spirit and led by the Spirit, how he was able to overcome the three temptations of Satan. And we know also from the Gospels that during the 40 days he was tempted by Satan, and not only during the 40 days, because at the end of the 40 days we read that Satan departed from him just for a season, but the temptation continued. And as the Lord Jesus Christ, who was filled with the Spirit and led by the Spirit, was victorious, when we are filled with the Spirit and led by the Spirit of God, we can overcome. And today I'd like to speak about five areas in which we can overcome through the power of the Holy Spirit. All of us, when we were baptized and we receive the Holy Spirit in the sacrament of Chrismation, so we have the Holy Spirit in us. And in these five areas, we should be victorious, not because of our power, but because of the power of the Holy Spirit abiding in us. The first area, to overcome the fear, to overcome the fear. As we read in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind. The Holy Spirit is a spirit of power. Many of us, because of fear, we miss out on important things. But God doesn't want us to live in fear. Before the crucifixion and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, people, for example, lived in fear of death, as we read in Hebrews chapter 2. And because they lived in fear of death, that's why they became enslaved. They became under bondage. We are slaves to whatever we fear. But when we are filled with the Holy Spirit will set us free, will empower us, will strengthen us. So we will not be afraid anymore. And the Holy Spirit will cast from our hearts every fear. We read Proverbs chapter 24, verse 10. If you faint in the day of adversity, if you are afraid and become fearful in the day of adversity, your strength is small. You have no power. Fear actually will make us weak. But when we are strong, when we are not fearful, then actually we will be strong. Many times the Lord rebuked the disciples, why are you afraid? Why are you fearful? And until now, we fear many things. We fear the future. We fear when there is adversity. We fear when there is hardship. So there are many insecurities inside us. And because of these insecurities, we become fearful. But the Holy Spirit, when fills us, actually will cast away any fear from our hearts. The second area, the Holy Spirit will make us victorious over our ungodly desires, or divine desires, or the ungodly passions inside us. St. Paul, in his letter to Romans, chapter 7, he spoke about the war between the carnal person and the spiritual person. As you know, St. Paul classified people into three categories: a carnal man, a natural man, and a spiritual man. You can read about it in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and chapter 3. Carnal man is the man who is led by the desires of the flesh. Natural man is led by his mind, by human wisdom. And a spiritual man is led by the Holy Spirit. So it's a quote in Romans chapter 7, verse 18, said, "For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells, for to will is present with me, but how to perform what is good I do not find." These words are the words of the carnal man. A carnal man who actually let the desires of the flesh control him. A carnal man can be actually a believer. And St. Paul, in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, he said, "Since there is conflict among you and divisions, aren't you carnal? Aren't you babes in Christ?" So they are not spiritually mature because they are not filled with the Spirit. But when I am filled with the Spirit and reach spiritual maturity, I will overcome all the vile desires, all the carnal desires inside me, and I will be walking in the Spirit. I will be led by the Spirit. That's why in Romans chapter 8, verse 1 and 2, St. Paul said, "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, carnal, but according to the Spirit, who walk according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death." That is the law of the carnal man. The words of the carnal man is expressed in this actually groaning of St. Paul when he said, "O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death?" But God gave us the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of victory, in order to walk by the Spirit, and thus we can overcome all the vile desires that is in us. Desires usually break our eyes away from God and focus on the things pertaining to this world. But when we are free from this carnal mind and we have the spiritual mind, then, as St. Paul said in Colossians chapter 3, "If you were raised with Christ, set your minds on things above, not on things below." The third area, so we said the Spirit of God gives us victory over fear, gives us victory over the ungodly and the carnal passions inside us. The third area, the Holy Spirit gives us victory over hardships. We know that in our life we will face many trials and we will face many hardships. Nobody will live without facing hardship here on earth. But God gave us the Holy Spirit in order to strengthen us. So when we face hardship, we will not fall under this difficulty or this adversity. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16, St. Paul was praying and saying that he was praying that God would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man. This strength comes from within to outside, from inside to outside, in the inner man. So when the Holy Spirit dwells in us, then even if we face hardship, we'll not be afraid. We see in the story of St. Peter when he was in prison, you know, Herod arrested James, son of Zebedee, and killed him. And after this, he arrested Peter, put him in prison, and was planning actually to kill him. And I want you to imagine if a person in prison waiting for his execution the following day, I'm sure this person wouldn't have any risk in his heart to be able to sleep. But St. Peter was actually sleeping deeply, to the extent that when God sent an angel to deliver St. Peter, has to shake him because he was sleeping deeply. How come St. Peter in prison has had this peace inside his heart? It is actually the power of the Holy Spirit who strengthened St. Peter in the inner man, as St. Paul said. And you see, St. Paul wrote a letter to Philippians. It's called the letter of joy. In each chapter, the word joy was repeated at least once. And in this letter, he said to the people, rejoice always in the Lord. And he wrote this letter when he was in prison. How come it is the Spirit of God who gives us victory over hardship? Also, how the Spirit of God, besides strengthening us, give us victory in hardship? Because the Spirit of God will inspire us with how can we respond, how we should react. In Luke chapter 12, verse 12, the Lord said, don't worry when they take you before the magistrates and authority, for the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say. Will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say. Also, the Holy Spirit is called the Comforter, because the Holy Spirit comforts us during the hardship and during the difficult time. As St. Paul mentioned in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, and said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. So when we are in hardship or in tribulation, as the hardship abounds, also the consolation abounds. As the suffering of Christ abounds in us, so our consolation also abounds through Christ. So the Holy Spirit makes us victorious, and we can overcome fear, can overcome ungodly desires, and we can overcome also hardship. Another area, the Holy Spirit help us overcome our limitation. As I told you, St. Paul differentiated between the carnal man, the natural man, and the spiritual man. Carnal man, as we explained, is led by the desires of the flesh. The natural man is limited. Why? because he is controlled by human experience, human wisdom, human principle, by his mind. That's why the carnal man, as Paul explained in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, he does not understand the things pertaining to the spirit. They are foolishness to him. He is limited by his mind and by the human wisdom and by the human experience. That is the problem with the natural man. But when we are filled with the Holy Spirit, we can actually understand things pertaining to the Spirit of God. Because now we have the Spirit and the mind of Christ. St. Paul said, now we have received not the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we also speak not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. How can we understand the mystery of incarnation? How can we understand the mystery of crucifixion and resurrection? How can we understand the mystery of Eucharist? How can we understand all these spiritual mysteries? We cannot by our natural man because we are limited. Only we can understand these things by the Spirit of God. These things we also speak not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. You can discern and understand these things only spiritually, only by the Holy Spirit. That's why he said in verse 15, but he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one. For who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him, but we have the mind of Christ? This limitation of the natural man, we can overcome it through the Holy Spirit, because we receive the Spirit from God. And this also will be reflected in our ministry. When we serve and when we preach, we don't preach relying on human wisdom or human philosophy. St. Paul, when he went to Greece, Corinth, he said to them, and my brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in wisdom of men, but in the power of God. However, we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age, who are coming to nothing, but we speak wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained for the ages, for our glory. And the last area, we said the Holy Spirit, Spirit of victory, will make us victorious over our fears, our carnal desires, during the time of hardships and tribulations, and our limitation, the limitation of the natural man. And the last area, the Holy Spirit gives us victory over the authority of the devil and the authority of sin. Before the crucifixion of our Lord Jesus Christ, the whole world was belonging to the devil. The devil was the prince of this world. And all of us were under the bondage and were slaves. In the baptism in the catechesis at the end of the baptism, Abuna says to the baptized person, the day in which you were born, you were a slave. But today, you are set free from this bondage. So, the Holy Spirit actually delivers us from the authority of the devil. During baptism, when we renounce Satan and we confess the Lord Jesus Christ, we are transferred from the kingdom of Satan to the kingdom of Christ. As St. Paul said in Colossians chapter 1, he transferred us to the kingdom of the Son of his love. So we are transferred to the kingdom of Christ. And the Holy Spirit gave us freedom. When Satan tried to take us captive again to his kingdom, then, because we have the Holy Spirit, we can overcome the authority of Satan. As we read in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, from verses 3 to 6, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God, for pulling down strongholds, casting down argument, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. So the person who is armed actually by the spiritual weapons, the Holy Spirit, when he put on the whole armor of God, now he can pull down a stronghold. He can cast down any argument and any every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. So the Holy Spirit is a spirit of victory. Now we should not be afraid. Now we should not actually be troubled during the time of hardships. Now we should not walk according to the flesh because we have victory over our vile desires. We should not walk according to our human mind because we have victory over the natural man. And also, we will not be enslaved anymore or under bondage anymore to Satan or to sin because of the Holy Spirit. As we see today in the temptation on the mountain, how the Lord Jesus Christ was able to defeat the power of Satan, and in his victory, because he was filled with the Spirit and led by the Spirit. In the same way, when we are filled with the Spirit, led by the Spirit, we have this victory. Let us dedicate the Divine Liturgy today to ask God to kindle the Holy Spirit in us, to help us to be filled with the Spirit, to help us to walk according to the Spirit, not to be carnal and not to be natural, but rather to be spiritual, carrying the power of the Holy Spirit in our hearts, in our life, in the inner man, all the days of our life. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.
Jesus, I pray.